So, colleagues, I guess we can smoothly start. It's already time. So, it's my pleasure to introduce you our today's speaker, Dr. Petr Satunin, who is a senior research fellow at Institute for Nuclear Research of the Russian Academy of Sciences in Moscow. So, he's visiting us today virtually, and he will tell us about their theoretical research on axion-like particles. So the topic of his talk is probing axion-like particles in nonlinear electrodynamics with radio frequency cavities. So in case if you have any questions, please either raise your hand. You may also ask the question by voice, but please make sure not to interrupt our speaker in the middle of the sentence. So Piotr, please, you're welcome. The stage is yours.
Okay, first, thank you, Maxim, very much for inviting me to make this talk. It's a very pleasure for me. So my talk is, I think, a little review talk about some experiments for searching axion-like particles or vacuum nonlinear electrodynamics with radio frequency cavities. And it is based on to our work, which is done in collaboration with my colleagues from Institute for Nuclear Research, Dmitry Kirpichnikov, Maxim Fitkevich, and students from Moscow State University, Dmitry Salnikov and Ilya Kapchinsky. So outline of my talk consists of three parts. In first part, I will briefly review what is axions and axion-like particles, and I introduce some strategies for searching axions and axion-like particles, so-called light shining through wall strategy. In a second time, I will make more detailed view to one part of these LSV type experiments with two radio frequency cavities. And in the third part of my talk, I will tell about some experiments with a single superconducting radio frequency cavity, in which you can probe not only axions and axion-like particles, but also some nonlinear interactions in vacuum. Okay, so your first part, what is axion and axion-like particles? New particle axion was introduced in, as I remember, in the 70s as a solution of so-called strong CP problem. But also people consider not only axions, but axion-like particles, which is a pseudoscalar particle coupled with photons, with electrodynamics. And the first introduced QCD axion is a part of this axion-like particle landscape with speech constraint. Okay, these axion-like particles may arise in quantum field theory from some string theories. From our side, axion-like particles is one of the most favored candidate to particle which may consist dark matter, and this particle can also explain some difficulties in propagation of extragalactic photons. There are some tension in it, and AP is one of possible explanations, but not only.
So, Peter, may I interrupt you and ask a small question? So, we know that for these QCD axions, there are like two possible values of this C gamma constant. So, basically, which gives the coupling constant. So, DFSZ and KSVZ. So, could you comment, please, how do people get these constraints? That's the first question. And then, what trick do they do? To extend parameter range and go from QCD axions to axion-like particles. So what assumptions do they make?
Okay, QCD axion interact with gluons with quantum thermodynamics, and quantum thermodynamics also interact with quarks, and quarks are charged particles charged with electromagnetic fields. So with some Luc diagrams with interaction with axions, went to quantum dynamics. There are some two models, QSVZ and DFSVZ, as I remember. And at the next slide, you can see with the area of G gamma parameter and ALP mass, and with yellow line, yellow stripe, is a QCD axion. ALP particle is always a graph, and the QCD axion is only with yellow line.
Yeah, nice. But
stripe.
But my question: how do they get this? How do they get this constraint? So, what kind of phenomena do they consider? Maybe in some general answer. I was curious about that.
I'm not very expert in it, but it was some loop contribution from QCD to this electrodynamics. And it depends on some QCD model. So this is not only line, but some thick stripe.
So, I mean, they derive these constraints from quantum chromodynamics, not from some astrophysical observations, not anything
yes,
like
yes,
that.
Yes.
Good, good.
With yellow stripe is from quantum chromodynamics.
Good. And then one more question, maybe we should go a slide back. So Christina is asking, does this particle behave like magnetic monopole being a pseudoscalar, or it's different? So could you comment slightly on that?
Ooh, it's different because so it's different.
Yeah, so maybe I could comment
magnetic.
For Christina. So
okay.
Magnetic monopole means that in the equations for divergence B, you get some non-zero. So this is a magnetic monopole. But axions, they give contributions to other Maxwell's equations. So a pair of Maxwell's equations with the sources. So Christina, is it okay answer, or maybe you want to ask some further details?
Maybe I will ask later. Thank you.
Good, good. Thanks.
Okay, may I continue?
Yes, please, please.
Yeah, at this slide you can see the area of ALP parameters. At the y-axis you can see the coupling constant between ALP and photons, and at the x-axis you can see the axion masses. So both axes are in logarithmic scale, and you can see the yellow stripe is a prediction of from QCD axions. And the other color relate other colors are related to some constraint. In upper left corner, you can see laboratory constraint. I will say about it in details later. Blue ones are constrained from astrophysics. If you know some constraint from astrophysics, you should assume that these axions or axion-like particles produced in stars, helioscopes, means in sun, helio, or in another stars. And detection is assumed to be in laboratory. With green at the right corner, some green constraints are related to cosmology. I don't tell about it now. In left side, gamma rays with small area is just preferred area for axion-like particles from astrophysical from astrophysical propagations for photons, but it not really preferred. But okay, so such axion-like particles may appear, may be, or may not be. So these small lines are related to helioscopes, which are detectors from axion dark matter. Okay, and you can see that in some area of masses you can reach the sensitivity of QCD axion. So can I move to next slide?
Peter, just a short question regarding this diagram.
Yeah.
So do we have any boundary from the region of low masses? So I see that there are strong constraints from cosmology for high masses.
Yeah.
But do we have anything like that for extremely small masses, 10 to the minus 11?
No, all boundaries at low masses are at the level 10 to minus 10.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it seems that in order to check if we have some ultralight particles, we need to go in sensitivity really far. So this KSFC limit is at ultra weak coupling constants, and then it seems impossible to check. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, a little theory. So with interaction Lagrangian for axion-like particles, with interaction with electromagnetic field, you can see axion axion interact with two components of electromagnetic field. So there is a way for axion-like particle production. Two components of electromagnetic field product ILP field in the language of field theory, or axion-like particle in the language of particle. So the first option is what will be two components is electromagnetic wave or photon, and the external magnetic field, which is so-called Primakov effect. And the second option is two electromagnetic waves product axion-like particle. And this interaction term also is responsible for axion-like particle detection. So if you have external axion-like particle and one component of electromagnetic field, so external magnetic field or external electromagnetic wave, it in this detection process, the signal electromagnetic wave is produced. And so these two types are crucial for some experiments probing axion-like particles. Production may occur in cosmology, some in cosmology process or in astrophysical process in stars, and detection may be in laboratory for with the cosmology or astrophysical production. These detectors are called holoscopes for dark matter or helioscopes, and so LP can be probed in a laboratory. Or another option, both production process and detection process may be, we may constrain such experiment in a laboratory, and the most usual type of such experiments is the light shining through wall experiment, which I describe in the next slide. And another option is to probe some induced for photon interaction induced by some axion-like particle, which is which is in addition to well-known quantum electrodynamics, linear photon interaction, and I will also talk about it.
So, Peter, maybe a short question at this point. So, how do these processes scale with this axion photon coupling constants, constant G? So, it's maybe an important one, just to have a broad picture.
Yes, it... it depends on the concrete process.
Yeah, but let's say if you consider the work of holoscope and assume that you have some axions already, and then you need to detect some electromagnetic field produced by them, then the signals scales as the first power of G, so electric field, and intensity scales as G squared. That's clear.
Yeah.
Now, if we take this light shining through walls experiment, then it seems that you get 1G when producing axions, and then you get another G when detecting them. And so the signal will be like G squared.
Yes, my signal is weaker. Okay, may I go one slide back? You can see with the telescopes, the sensitivity to the coupling constant is very good, but the range for action mass is very small. So with only with green lines that goes to with QCD actions, but they're very very narrow. So if you want to if you want to probe all range of these action masses, you should use a lot of different telescopes for every with the narrow band.
Mm-hmm.
And but the laboratory experiments are not so so sensitive for the gamma gammas. But one of this laboratory experiment is sensitive to all range of action mass,
mm-hmm.
LP
okay.
mass.
Thanks.
Okay. So the previous slide, I told about the variance of production detection for axions, and in the 80s, several physicists from Soviet Union and France, PRCKV, proposed to the strategy for some laboratory experiment to probe with axions. The area of experiments is divided by production volume and detection volume. In the production volume, some electromagnetic wave is propagated in magnetic field, and due to this Primakov process, it may produce the axion. With detecting volume is divided by from the production volume by non-opacity plate with the black one, and gamma rays photons don't travel through this wall, but axions can travel to this wall through this wall to the right dark side because with the volume without any electromagnetic wave, but this site is full of magnetic field and the axions or LPs which travel through this wall can produce some electromagnetic field signal, electromagnetic field in this in magnetic in external magnetic field B. So the light transfers oscillates to some axion-like particles, which goes through the wall, and in the dark room behind the wall, it oscillates back to electromagnetic field to photon in the external magnetic field. It is a little bit similar to neutrino oscillations. If you consider maybe optical effect, okay. And this strategy may be realized in experiment with in optical range or with radio frequencies. So in optical range, you have a laser which goes through some optical cavities in the, at the left. You can see production cavity in which axion-like particles may produce and go through with gray non-opacity wall. In the detection cavity, with axion that appear here, can transfer back in magnetic field into photons, which which intensity can be increased in the Fabry-Pérot cavity and which can be detected by photon detectors. The same may be probed with radio frequency cavities, and so you can see a large magnet in this Crowes experiment, where is an emitting cavity in which radio frequency mode can transfer to axion-like particles, which goes through the cavity shielding box to the detecting cavities, and in detecting cavity, it transfer back to a electromagnetic mode that can be detected by microwave signal detector. And in this plot from the review from Rastorz and Redondo, you can see the laboratory experiments in more details. So you can see that both laser experiments like ELPS-1 and OSCAR and radio frequency experiments, Crowes, can reach the same sensitivity 10 to minus 7 GeV. So it is, from one side, it is three orders of magnitude less than some gyroscopes like CAST, but for laboratory experiments like LSV, you are independent on the some astrophysical model, because you can touch the sun and you cannot be very you cannot say that axions, you cannot be sure about physics in the sun. So it may be different models of the sun, and these 10 to minus 10 constraints may be not very robust as laboratory constraints.
But so my question is comparison with the holoscopes, let's say. If we compare with the holoscopes,
okay.
So we can cover like smaller masses. So could you comment on that?
Oh, yes, you can cover so smaller masses because these masses are from 10 to minus. Okay, these masses goes from zero, really from zero, to this, from zero to the frequency of initial photon. So 10 to minus 6, 10 to minus 5 is it's about 1 gigahertz radio frequency. And for optical, it's 10 to minus 4 to the optical sum.
But so this ALPS 3 is projected experiment or it's already done?
No. ALPS 3 is only projected. ALPS 2 is under construction.
Okay.
Now.
Okay. Good.
Okay, ALPS 1 is finished, but with stacks, ALPS 3 are only projected. So, okay. So, finished experiments, optical and the frequency experiments, really the same sensitivity to the gamma-gamma. And now, under construction is ALPS 2 experiment, which plans sensitivity is 2 times 10 to minus 11 GeV, 2 minus 1. And no cavity experiments at the construction. There are only projects of this. Something about different types of this cavity experiment. There is a recent progress in last years with some superconducting radio frequency cavities, and the superconducting radio frequency cavities has larger quality factors up to 10 to 12, as I know in Fermilab. So larger quality factors means larger amplitudes for electromagnetic modes and electric field in cavity like 50 megavolt to meter divided to meter is discussed. From our side, large magnetic field destroys superconducting state of walls of the superconducting cavities. Maximal critical magnetic field at very low temperature is for niobium superconducting state. It is maximum with critical magnetic field is 0.2 tesla. And with the superconducting cavities can be also used as both as a production or detection cavity. And in recent years, there are some proposals appeared in which superconducting radio frequency cavities may be considered as a production cavity or as a detection cavity or both. So with you can see these articles and which pros of superconducting radio frequency cavities for axion-like particle search one can mention. There is a you may reach the large sensitivity 10 to minus 10 or 10 to minus 11 GeV to minus 1 with sensitivity level is the level of gyroscope cast or constructed ALPS 2, but some technical issues of this type of experiment are not described in details. In considering some experimental project, some maybe difficulties in techniques may be appeared. Okay, and in our article with Dima Sальников, Dima Krepichnikov, and Maxim Kshetkevich, we considered the following setup. There are two cavities, production cavity and detection cavity, divided by non-opacity plate. In production cavity is superconducting radio frequency cavity. We consider two modes, two eigenmodes of electromagnetic field in it. And we make a condition of surface magnetic field of these electromagnetic modes is 0.1 tesla because the maximal magnetic field is 0.2 tesla. And we take usual radio frequency cavity, not superconducting, as a detection cavity. So no condition on this magnetic field, so you can take maybe 10 tesla for this magnetic field if you can make some magnet.
But so, Peter, there is a question here.
Yeah.
So you prefer to use superconducting
yeah.
cavity as a production one in order to decrease, so you are using some low temperatures, so why you need superconductors here?
Yeah, because we want to compare superconducting cavities with conducting cavities like in experiment Crowes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
which is better? We don't know now.
Okay. Yeah, because in the case of usual cavity, you can go to higher magnetic field. It seems like several tesla is easily achievable. You can go
yeah.
even as high as 10 tesla in some cases. So.
In fact, I think really previous maybe even more preferable from the point of view of experimentalist because superconducting cavity maybe it's more difficult to construct it to maybe. To cool it for this temperature 1 Kelvin or maybe lower, and
mm-hmm.
But we consider it calculate some axion density and consider detection with it. But I'm not sure that it is a bad experiment. Maybe it is not the best.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so a little bit theory. So Lagrangian and from the Lagrangian you can obtain the equation of motion for action-like particles and for signal photons. So the equation of motion for action-like particles is noted as equation one, and it is Klein-Gordon equation with a source, and source is two electromagnetic modes, two cavity modes, which is usually noted by transversal magnetic mode and transversal electric mode with some indices. And the solution of this equation can be considered as two waves with two frequencies, which is a sum or which is omega 1 plus or minus omega 2, and the solution for each frequency term is the following. So, and equation 2 is the equation of motion for signal mode about photon regeneration in the external field of this axion and in magnetic field.
So may I clarify a little bit? So, so imagine you have two modes in the cavity, some T and TM. They have some more or less close frequencies. So do you expect that there will be some mixing between these modes, right? Due to axiom.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then you get basically, I would expect that axions slightly renormalize the frequencies of those modes, but you are speaking about some and different frequency generation. So this seems to be like one more nonlinear effect, right? So they provide the source of effective nonlinearity, these axions.
So can you repeat?
So do axions provide some effective source of nonlinearity?
Nonlinearity for electromagnetic field?
Yes.
Yes, I will say about it later.
Good, okay.
Okay. So we numerically calculate with A plus minus axion field and make some plots for the axion like particle density. So you can see two frequency paths, omega plus and omega minus, and here you consider the cylinder with 1 meter length and 1 meter for radius. And here you can see the axion-like particle density. At the right plots, you can see the plus component. The plus component resonates at axion mass, which is equal to omega plus at the upper right plot, and up down plot you can see the special distribution at the resonance mass, a special distribution of LP density at the resonant mass. And at the left side, you can see the same plots for minus component. You can see that the density is two orders of magnitude less than for plus component. So at the later, we will consider only plus component.
So, but maybe one short question.
Yeah.
So, is the axion contribution equivalent to chi 2 nonlinearity or chi 3 nonlinearity? So, if we speak about in the language of optical nonlinearities, just to match with what we know from nonlinear optics, maybe.
It is not the same as in nonlinear optics because here you produced some. Okay, it's like K3 because the interaction is cubic.
Basically, this axion field is proportional to E dot B, so square of field, roughly speaking.
Yeah.
Then you get the polarization, which is proportional to axion field times, let's say, electric field. So you get cube.
Yes.
It's K3. So therefore, there should be some random normalization of this frequency of this of the cavities, some slight mixing of the modes. I believe this can be done via perturbation theory because this axion field is extremely weak. So, well, I'm not an expert in that, but as a naive guess. But you are focusing on this markedly new physics, which is sum and difference frequency generation.
Yes.
But then the follow-up question, so to get sum or difference frequency generation, you basically need Chi2 nonlinearity, not Chi3. So in the presence of Chi3, you can get third harmonic or sum or difference of three frequencies. Three, not two. So do you have some static fields here?
I think the optical analogy is not very good for this. It is good for the next part because, okay, I will say about some optical analogy here. Here you have a closed volume with two electromagnetic waves and axion produced in this volume and goes from this to the other side.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, that seems clear.
I think it is not very like to optical analogy, but I will say later some nonlinearity.
Okay, good. Okay, so I see a question. Sorry for interrupting. Mm-hmm. So there is a question from Timur. So Timur, please go ahead.
Yeah.
Yes, I have a question concerning the scale of the resonator. It is known that the interaction constant for the axions scales with energy. Thus, to effectively detect the axion, you need and produce the axion, you need to change the cylinder size, right? Because otherwise you can fall out of the resonant frequencies for the cylinder. Do you consider this when you do this experiment or calculate it numerically?
Yes, of course. So the resonant, this resonant mass is equal to omega plus frequency, which depends on, which inversely depend on the cavity dimensions. So if you increase the resonator, the cavity, the mass will be resonant mass will be lower.
No. I'm not talking about the resonant mass. I'm talking about the interaction constant G A gamma gamma. I mean that on different frequencies, right? For the producing fields or detecting fields, you need to have a different cylinder sizes. As far as I see it. Because in other way, because
no, it's only for holoscopes. No, not for these LSV experiments. But so for holoscopes, maybe I missed something. Maybe later.
Okay, maybe we can leave this question to the discussion.
Okay.
So, by the way, so Peter, no worries if you will not have enough time to cover all the slides. It's better that we understand some basics, discuss it, and that would be much better.
Maybe. Okay. Okay, and because it maybe was a mistake to try to include all topics in these slides. Okay, so may I go to the next slide?
Yes, please.
Yes. Okay, in this slide you can see the energy density for LPs for different pump modes in the production cavity. So you can see that the previous configuration was the best, but TM 011 plus TA 012 is also good. I want to skip some maybe technical details for which pump mode combinations are good and why, because it's some numerics shows it, and maybe it is a little bit boring. I think we discuss it in our article. This LP energy density also depend on the geometry of cavity. What I mean by the word geometry, it's the ratio of radius to the length. You can consider the cylinder of one cubic meter volume, but it may be very thin or very thick. And for the same volume, you can see the different situation, different energy distribution for produced XL-like particles. It is more better to plot some radiation pattern for XL-like particle production. Here is analytical calculation in the far zone. So the cylinder is located in the center of this half circles, and it is very small. But what can you see at small masses? These thin cylinders where most of energy emits in the axial direction, but at the resonant mass where all energy emitted in the all direction with the same intensity. And at the right plot, you can see that thin cylinder is related to axial emission, but if you may if you consider more thick cylinder is related to axial emission, and if you consider the cylinder more thin, the radiation pattern diagram changes, and for very thin cylinder-like tube, the most axial-like particles emit not from the axial but to radial direction. So depending on which cylinder you for the right for the red diagram, you can consider detection cavity at the with cylinder axis, but for the long tube, you should consider detection cylinder in parallel.
But so, Peter, a short question, just to make sure that we understand. So, do I understand correctly?
Yeah.
Depending on the mass of axion, so you should reconfigure your device differently, putting the detection cylinder either on the axis or off axis, because you have different radiation patterns.
No, that's not the point, because what is the good thing for this LSV type, you can do one geometry and you can probe all axions, all axion masses from zero to with the resonant mass.
Mm-hmm. But how does this...
Depending on the geometry, some masses may be a little bit more, you can be sensitive a little bit more for some masses, it is not some orders of magnitude, but maybe factors like, really factors like two or three, not very large factors.
Okay.
I will show it in the last plot of this part.
Yep.
Okay, about detection, there are some little bit difficulties with detection. So you have the Maxwell equation with external source, external current, which is connected with external axion field and magnetic field, constant magnetic field located in the detection cavity. Because of this unknown, initially unknown axion field, you should make this very accurately, and so divide some potential part, which appears because of different boundary conditions, but it's some technical details, and you find some resonance for some mod. So here you can see that detection cavity has a number of eigenmodes with some eigenfrequencies, and if frequency of external axion is equal to the eigenfrequency of some cavity mode, there is a resonance, and really you should add some decrement gamma to this with frequency omega in order to not obtain some infinity. Decrement gamma is related to dissipation, so quality factor is inverse value of with dissipation decrement gamma. So finally, one obtains the resonance signal amplitude for the signal mode, which is the same for electric part and the magnetic part, and is expressed by the following formula. So A of X is some external field that went to with some production cavity, and similar things appeared for holoscopes, but it is much simpler for holoscopes because if dark matter is from axions, it is non-relativistic, so there is no some this A of X, and so in holoscopes you should have a non-constant external magnetic field, but it's a little bit different from holoscopes.
Mm-hmm. So Petr, I just wanted to let you know that it's like we have around 10 minutes, so maybe we can skip some parts, focus on some others. Yeah.
Okay. I will skip some formulas and go to these plots. At these plots, you can see the sensitivity to G gamma gamma for some sets of cavity modes, some sets of modes of production cavity, and the numerics are the following. So you can 10 Tesla, 0.1 Tesla for electromagnetic modes in protection cavity, and so on, so on, which is, I think, quite far from, no, not very cool, not, yes, I think, quite far from current technology, but in, I think one may reach with. Okay, so you can see that the TM0010 plus T101 is the best, think the best set of mods. So you can see it use these mods. And you can see the resonance at here. But this experimental setup is sensitive not only for this resonance, but for all axion mass from zero to this 10 to minus 6 electron volt. And the next plot, you can also compare, it is related to axial geometry, this one, and also you may consider radial geometry, infraradial geometry. So with plot in this plot you can compare axial and radial geometry for zero axion mass and resonant axion mass, and here at the with axis you can see the dependence of G gamma gamma on the ratio radius to the length, and you see it depends on this ratio, but by the way, it is the same order of magnitude for thin production cavity and for thick production cavity. But okay, it depends, so you can use this or this. It's preliminary because you can see some strange things for zero axion mass, and we will recalculate it. Okay, and very, very briefly, the last part is a very large part of my talk. So, nonlinear electrodynamics, there is a contribution from from the loop of virtual electrons to four-point interaction, and also you can consider the contribution from some new particle physics to this four-point interaction as well. And this four-point interaction may be probed with some cavities, and this idea of experiment was proposed in 20 years ago, but in 3 years ago, this experiment was reminded in context of axion search, when instead of the previous two-cavity experiment, here you see a single cavity in which two pump modes create a signal mode of this frequency by such nonlinear process. And these authors proposed some far from current technology as well, but phase one maybe constructed in several years if we want, if we have some money for it. So I think this is very beautiful and elegant experiment. So you have for photon interaction, and you may also think about the third harmonics and some signal modes with sign plus, but these people numerically calculated only sign minus, And so what happens with our options? So we have harmonics is not generated in one dimensional cavity, which is a capacitor, and we try to probe some other options analytically. So some technicalities, linear Maxwell equations, in a similar way to the detection of the previous part, you can consider the detection here, so you can see the resonance, and you can introduce dissipation and solve this classical wave equation in similar with hierarchy in perturbative regime for signal modes. And we can consider first the one-dimensional cavity, which is capacitor, and obtain that there is no resonance for triple frequency, 3 omega n. So it is where at this classical effective theory calculations, the reason is unknown, but we obtain it. And for me, it's interesting to consider some quantum calculations, but about classical calculations, maybe I go to the summary of classical part. So we made some calculations with computer algebra system Maxima, and it was some combinatorial calculations, and maybe a little bit boring. So the answer is the third harmonics is not resonantly amplified both in one dimensional and three dimensional, and the combined harmonics with sine plus is also not resonantly amplified, but only harmonics with sine minus can be resonantly amplified for some certain resonant ratio of cavity dimensions. And we present analytically explicit solution for some thing for some point. And as previous authors, Bogorad and Erickson, we made the similar solutions for cylinders, but numerical, and we make some analytical solution. And there are some open questions about it. What's the reason for the absence of third harmonics? Because it's a massless vector theory, but in scalar lambda phi to the fourth theory, this process occurs. And what is the quantum description of resonant generation of generation of the harmonics with sine minus? Because if you consider 3-to-1 process, merging process in QFT, the final result should have, final particle should have energy 2 omega 1 plus omega 2. So we want to consider it at quantum level, and we find all answers on these questions. So we for this quantum approach, you can use, I think, Schwinger-Keldysh technique, but at first we want to some modify some S-matrix formalism, because it you cannot apply directly, but for some rectangular cavities, you can divide the quantum cavity modes into a linear combination of plane waves, and so you can use it. And so we also introduce dissipation, and so the quantum states of the one-dimensional cavities. These quantum states was described in context of the Casimir effect before, and so the reason is that amplitude 3-to-1 merging, it decomposes to 16 plane wave amplitudes, 14 amplitudes of beta zero, and so the amplitude 3-to-1 for plane waves may contain only scalar products of momenta due to because with theory of plane waves Lorentz invariant, and since the theory is massless and the plane waves all momenta of plane waves are parallel in 1D, all these scalar products are zero. So this is the reason for the first question that appeared when we consider this problem at classical level. And the same for three-dimensional rectangular cavity. So this is really the reason for the non-generation of third harmonics in three-dimensional rectangular cavity, because everything decomposes on plane waves, and some amplitudes between plane waves are zero due to energy momentum conservation, and some amplitudes are amplitudes other amplitudes are amplitudes for parallel momenta, and they vanish in the same way. And for 2 omega 1 minus omega 2, this argument does not work. And the second question was that the generation of 2 omega 1 minus omega 2 is forbidden for one particle state due to energy momentum conservation, but you should consider coherent states instead of one particle states. So we could, I'm sorry. So you can, we have calculated when matrix element for coherent state. Okay, some technicalities, and the result coincides with a classical approach. Okay, and I'm sorry.
Yeah, so maybe Peter, maybe I should ask you a short question about this mechanism. So roughly speaking, you are saying that the process of generation 2 omega 1 minus omega 2 is somehow much stronger than the process of generation 2 omega 1 plus omega 2, right? So did I understand that correctly? Is this somehow related intrinsically to the fact that axion field, it breaks time reversal symmetry? So does it have something to do with time reversal symmetry breaking?
No. Here, because I think no. So
can we connect this to some general to some general principles? Let's say so. It was hard to understand the details, but maybe you can give some broader picture, some link to the general principles.
Because this machinery related not only to axions but to first to linear electrodynamics, so it is not related on the presence of axions.
Yes, but nonlinearity emerges from this effective axion response, right? So
yes, but not only from axions. It's from the box diagram.
So it's just intrinsic nonlinearity of vacuum. So
yes,
it also has.
Yes.
So we have both sources of nonlinearity, right? Right. So can we jump to the conclusions, and maybe we have some questions. Actually, I have a couple of them.
So in some experimental issues for this one cavity experiment, because you have four photon nonlinearity in vacuum inside the cavity, and also you have some walls of this superconducting cavity, and this is a medium in which it may be some nonlinearities in media. So one may expect the same effect from the nonlinearities in walls on this signal mode as from some vacuum effect. And in this article, the amplitude of from some nonlinearities walls was so calculated. So in order to get rid of these nonlinearities from walls, you need to have ultra-clean superconductors and ultra-low temperatures, which I am not sure that it is reachable with our technology, but it, maybe I'm not sure about the real quantities, but for my opinion is maybe it is very strong difficulties to make some ultra-low temperature. Sure, because it's I think very hard to cool with the cavity with two modes of very large amplitude. It's very hard to cool it to something 10 millikelvin or lower. So I think it's very hard. Okay, and thank you for attention. Okay.
Yes, thank you so much, Piotr. So we have some time for questions. Actually, both parts are very interesting. So colleagues, in case if you have any questions, please raise your hand. So I remember that we had some potential question from Christina. So, but before that, just a general question. So in this type of experiments, light shining through walls, so you consider production of axions by electromagnetic field and then conversion of these axions back to electromagnetic signal. So my question is, does the presence of some background axion signal, so which comes, you know, from the distant stars, which is ubiquitous, somehow affect the results of your calculations? Because it doesn't seem that you take this into account. So could you comment on that, please?
Production of axions from stars.
Yeah, because there is some background signal.
Yeah, about stars, I I didn't think about it, but no, I'm not sure, but in my opinion, where a signal from stars is a very strong at the source, but near the detector, it is weaker than the signal from nearby production cavity, but really I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's the issue to be checked, because there is, as people like Frank Vilchik are teaching us, that, you know, there is a almost constant density of this axion dark matter in the universe, which corresponds to, if I'm correct, 0.45 giga electron volts per centimeter cubic centimeter. So and then you need to compare the amount of axions which you can potentially produce with that one, because this background signal can deteriorate the performance of the whole system, let's say. So maybe they don't affect, but we need to understand why.
Yeah, I think it should compare with signal, because it may be of the same order, maybe larger.
And then I have one more question. So in this, again, regarding the first part of the talk, so do you consider some strategies to boost axion production by playing with the geometry of the cavity? So I saw that you are changing aspect ratio, the ratio between the radius and the height, but do you consider some maybe other strategies which could strongly enhance axion production? So what do you think on that?
Out of strategies, you mean some maybe increase some external axion flux from dark matter or stars?
No, I would mean playing with some geometry, because in electromagnetics we know that by playing with the geometry, by playing with the antenna, let's say, design, you can suppress or enhance radiation.
So here we play with geometry. Okay, so we try to try to explore. But as you can see here, the difference between axial and radial geometry is not so good, because
yeah,
it's 10 to minus 10, 10 to minus 11.
But
so,
to put it simply, so if you want to produce a lot of axions, you need to make sure that in some volume you have strong and parallel electric and magnetic field, because E dot B is just the
yes.
source of your axion, roughly speaking.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
then my question is, so you assume that you create somehow strong magnetic field, so it's given, and then mm-hmm. you need to make sure that electric field is somehow aligned in a parallel way to that. If it is orthogonal, you do not get any axion generation. Well, as a simple picture. And so then you can optimize somehow your electromagnetic modes in such a way that in a desired place you have this parallel alignment. So did you do some kind of optimization for that purpose?
Yeah. In such a way, to consider not a cylinder, but another geometry, no, but I think cylinder is better than rectangular cavity, but
mm-hmm.
maybe
mm-hmm.
some cavity like another form, I'm not sure, but I think if you can if you go better, it will be not very large step to
mm-hmm.
down, because as you can see here with G gamma gamma sensitivity is the power 1 over 4 of some components, and with geometry sits in the coefficient kappa. And it is not very large, large
and
dependency
then,
of this.
Yeah,
but
then
it
you
maybe
need...
it was maybe factor 2 or maybe something like that. So
uh-huh.
it's maybe.
Uh-huh. Okay, and then you need a lot of scanning time. So I see 10 to the 6 second, million of seconds.
Yeah.
Is it around 1 year?
Yeah.
Just to estimate.
1 year is 3 is pi seconds, 3 to 10 to 7 seconds,
uh-huh.
but it's, I think, 1 month, maybe it's
1 month.
Around
okay.
1 month.
Good.
Okay.
Good. And then a very naive question regarding the last part of your presentation. So,
mm-hmm.
As we know from quantum electrodynamics, indeed there is some vacuum nonlinearity. So I wonder if there
yes.
were some experiments testing that. So is it reachable with the current experiments? Just plain vacuum non-linear.
Yes, yes. Yes. It's it's very, very interesting. I think that I studied some Schwinger effect and Schwinger
mm-hmm.
type effects. It was not detected to this moment, but it may be reached, I think, in the next 10 years, because in several strategies, just induce Schwinger effect with lasers, some polarization experiments. It was some polarization experiment which was finished in, I think, 5 years ago, and the sensitivity was the one order of magnitude lower than Ehlen-Geisenberg contribution, but one may make some maybe more sensitive polarization experiments, and so experiments like this, so you can probe vacuum nonlinearity with this experiment. So for my opinion, phase two is related to Ehlers-Geisenberg level nonlinearity from vacuum electrodynamics,
mm-hmm.
and I think the difficulty is the nonlinearity in the walls, but if you can solve this problem, I think you can
mm-hmm.
make this experiment as well, because
again, a very naive question. So the contribution from axions to this nonlinear phenomena should be comparable with that of the usual nonlinearity of vacuum, so to speak, or they have different
yes.
orders of magnitude. Comparable.
Yes, it may be comparable. Phase two is the level of Euler-Heisenberg, and if you construct phase three, you can go beyond Euler-Heisenberg. But now it seems that phase one is it's more realistic to this moment, but depends of progress in technology, maybe 10 or 15 years.
Okay.
If to be optimistic, but maybe not.
Yeah.
It's optimistic.
Yeah, but I mean, you have to be fast because other guys are also working some other approaches to search for axions, those holoscopes. So if they discover, all is done. Yeah. So
okay,
nice talk. Thank you. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you so much. So, colleagues, do you have any other questions? Maybe some follow-up questions? Well, I don't see other questions from the audience. We interrupted you a lot, but I hope we got some understanding and it was also useful for you. Thanks a lot for coming, giving a nice talk.